Okay, so in today's session, we have a Facebook AI researcher currently known as Meta, and he's also part of Mila and then Udom as an alumni, where he was advised by Dr. Yoshua Bengio and Jiang Tang. Like he was doing his master's, so currently he's doing his research in AI. His current area of interest are like reinforcement learning, lifelong learning. Is doing a lot of contribution to open source in PyTorch. So we are pleased to have and then honored to have Shagun to conduct our today's advanced PyTorch tutorial. Thank you for accepting and being here, Shagun.
Thank you. Nice to be here. Do we want to wait a little longer for some more people
Yeah,
to join?
we'll give a couple of minutes and then we can join. Start.
Okay.
Parallelly, can you share the collab link or if there is any reference material for the students to view
Yeah,
the chat,
most
it
of
would
it
be great.
is going to be based on the collab which we had last time. Some of it is also, yeah, some of this is a rehash of a PyData doc. So you can see the slides here.
Awesome. Can I start talking? I think more people will be joining.
Let's see. You need to enable screen sharing for me.
Oh, sorry. You check now?
Yes, now I can share.
Awesome.
You see the screen?
Yeah.
Okay. Before we actually get into the profiling part, this is the notebook that we were using last time. There are two or three things I want to highlight, which are not really advanced use cases, but just good to know stuff, which can be very handy. Okay, is the zoom level good, or should I zoom in a bit more?
I think it's good.
Okay.
Can you share this collab link also in the chat? Like, if
It's
some should be
the one from last time. I can share it once again. How do I do that? So let's get started because we have quite a lot of things to work. So the first thing is, let's say I want to make this is not advanced PyTorch. We'll come to it in a minute. These are just a few things that are easy to get wrong. So let's say I am making this model. I'm calling it as a 100-headed model. Since it's a PyTorch model, I am inheriting or extending the class NN.module. In this, I have a base classifier, a base layer, which is an NN.linear. And then I have a lot of heads, a lot of layers. In fact, I have 100 of them. So I make a base layer, I make 100 head layers, and each head layer is an NN dot linear. And it looks like a good or a correct model definition, right? But in reality, this is actually not correct, because if you look at the model summary, you would see that only one layer is identified, only the base layer is identified. So even though we did make a lot of heads and we put them into a Python list, this is not correct. because any network defined inside a Python list is not registered properly. So if you want to maintain a list of modules or a list of networks, instead of using a vanilla Python list, you should be using this construct called as module list. So you make your list, but you wrap that list into a module list, and then those modules would be properly registered, as you can see here. So TLDR, if you want to have a list of models, instead of putting them into a single list or a Python list, put them or wrap them inside this construct called as module list. And the same argument applies for a dictionary as well. So if you want to have a dictionary of models, instead of just making a plain Python dictionary, make a dictionary and then wrap it in module length like this. So you make the dictionary and then you wrap it in module length. If you don't do it, then the parameters would not be registered properly. This is one thing that is easy to get wrong. The second thing I wanted to highlight was the different, of course, feel free to go through these things. It's still useful. The other big thing I wanted to highlight was the difference between parameters, buffers, and modules. And this becomes relevant once you start implementing anything which is slightly advanced. So PyTorch provides you three things. It provides you a buffer. It provides a buffer construct. It provides a parameter construct and a module construct. So what exactly is the difference here? A module is basically this nn.module instance. So a module is a standard, PyTorch module. A parameter is a tensor which can be learned or for which we are tracking the gradients. So let's say I make a linear layer. So the linear layer is the module, and the weights and the biases of the linear layer are the parameters. So that's the difference between module and parameter. And you can make parameters of your own as well. So you can make both these things. The third thing is a buffer. A buffer is a tensor, but you do not track the gradients for this tensor. And why would we care about a tensor for which we do not track gradients? Well, consider the example of implementing batch norm by yourself. So when you're implementing batch norm, you want to track the mean and the variance, but you don't really want to backtrack through it. So you just want to track it. You just want to aggregate it. And in a case like that, buffer is the usual or the correct construct. So the TLDR is, if you have, let's say, a ResNet model, then each convolutional layer is a module. The weights of the convolutional layer are parameters, and then you would have some buffers for tracking the batch statistics if you have the batch norm layers. Is there any question? If not, we can go to the advanced PyTorch part now. So these are two things that I wanted to quickly cover. Okay. Cool. There are some more examples here, so feel free to pass through it. And with buffers and parameters and so on, you can have named buffers, named parameters, but that's not super, super important. Okay, so let's look at the profiling use cases. Instead of first looking at profiling, we would look at how to make PyTorch go faster, and then we'll come back to profiling. I'm doing it this way so that I can spend more time on these tips and tricks for tuning PyTorch, because I think that's more interesting, more useful, and then we can come back to the profiling part. So the tips and tricks part starts here. Just a disclaimer, this is for PyTorch 1.9.1, which means some of these things may not be available in the previous versions of PyTorch, and some of these, and the latest version 1.10 has some extra things. So this is one checkpoint in time, which is 1.9.1. Okay, so let's start with some of these tricks. The first thing is, when you are doing data loading, when you are creating a data loader, by default, PyTorch data loaders use a single process. So you create a data loader. So it's, let's say you are reading a bunch of files from the disk. So there would be one process which would be reading one file at a time, putting it into the buffer, then second file, putting it into the buffer, and so on. And in that sense, you are blocked. Your model is blocked unless a batch is ready. And once a batch is ready, it passes on to the model, and the model does a forward pass, and so on. So the TLDR is, since it's a single process data loading, you may have to spend a lot of time. If reading the data or creating a batch is a slow process, creating a batch may also be slow, because maybe reading the file is very fast, but you are applying a lot of transformations on the data that you have read. So whenever you are in a setup like this, where you are spending a lot of time in your data loader, you can convert the data loader into a multi-processing based data loader, And for that, you just need to pass this extra flag called as num workers equal to some positive number. And this positive number is basically the number of workers that you want to use. So if you pass 5, this means it would be 5 workers who would be creating the, or who would be filling this batch for you. And this can reduce the time that you wait for the data loading to be complete. There's a link where you can read more about how the multiprocess data loading works. There's a slight caveat, which is sometimes you may run into issues where the moment you enable num workers, you start seeing memory leakage. And that's a common issue. And let me talk a bit about why that happens and how you can avoid it. The simple answer to avoiding it is, or rather the simple answer to why it happens is, it happens when you are using Python constructs in, when you're using Python constructs for creating the, or for reading or loading the data. So for example, you might be using list or dictionaries, and the way to avoid it is start using NumPy arrays instead of list, or start using Torch tensors instead of list and arrays. And the more sort of deeper reason for why this happens is when you have Python objects, and when you access them, you create a copy on write, which means you would have a lot of references, and these lot of references just quickly blow up. Another reason this happens is when you have a list, let's say you have a list of 100 files or 100,000 files. Python would maintain a reference for every single entry. Whereas when you have a NumPy array, there would be one reference for the entire array. So these are some of the reasons because of which this happens. It's more of a, I wouldn't exactly call it a bug, it's more of a behavior. And if that is something that you run into, the easy way to avoid it is start using NumPy or Torch tensors directly instead of playing with list or dictionaries and so on. And if you have any questions, or you have tried data multiprocess data loading or any of these things that we are talking about, and you saw some caveats, you know, feel free to speak up. Okay, and the slides are shared, so you can go to the further reading link and read up more about this. But the multiprocess data loading, it's one of those nice things which almost always gives you a good performance improvement. Okay, let's look at the next one. The next one is also related to data loaders, or specifically related to how fast you load the data. So let's say you have a PyTorch model which is on the GPU, and then you are reading the data first into the CPU, and from CPU you are sending the data to the GPU by doing a dot loop. So what happens is, by default, you read the data into CPU and then you push it to the GPU. And this process would take some time. And there's a way to accelerate that by copying the data into pinned memory. The basic idea behind the pinned memory is that data transfer from CPU to GPU, when you're using pinned memory, that data transfer is faster. And the way to enable pinned memory is when you're creating the data loader, you can pass an argument called as pinned memory. And you can just set pin memory equal to true, and then the data would be fetched into a pin memory, and the transfer from that to the GPU would be faster. So this is again one of those good things that almost always help you and improve the performance. And you can read more about it. So the previous previous optimization, as well as the memory pinning part, both of them are directly related to the data loader when you are loading the data from CPU. Memory pinning applies only when you're copying the data to GPU. If you're not copying the data to GPU, memory pinning is not going to do anything for you. Whereas the previous one, the one where we were using multiprocessing, that is applicable whether you are training on CPU or on GPU. Okay. The third optimization, or the third useful thing to know about, is this thing called as an inference mode. So let's see what happens. So when you have a Torch tensor and you are doing certain operations on it, so let's say I make a Torch tensor X and I do something like Y is equal to X times X. When I do Y is equal to X times X, Torch is tracking gradients. Torch is tracking all the operations because it thinks that you might ask for gradients later on. So at some point you could say, hey, do something like Y dot backward or so. So PyTorch is tracking, is creating this compute graph, and it's tracking all the gradients. And in some cases, you may be 100% sure that there is no case in which you would compute the gradient for an operation. And in those cases, if you explicitly tell PyTorch that you're not going to request the gradients later on, PyTorch can stop tracking those things, and that can give you a performance boost. And one way of doing that is the inference mode. Inference mode is probably the most sort of strict version of this. And I'll talk about what I mean by the strict version, but the point is the moment you enable inference mode, it is going to disable all view tracking. It's not going to keep track of any version counters. And you should do it only when you're 100% sure that you're not going to be interacting with AutoGrad in any way whatsoever. So whenever you're doing model inference or you're evaluating the model's performance on the validation data, the inference mode is a good candidate to use because on validation you're not, or on testing, you're not going to update the model. Now, I said that this is the strictest mode because there are a bunch of other things that you can do for disabling the gradient computation. So there's inference mode, then there's something called as no grad mode. No grad mode basically disables gradient tracking locally, which means if I perform an operation under the no grad mode, the gradient for that operation would not be tracked, which means that operation would be slightly faster, but it would not be as fast as the inference mode. So the TLDR is, if you're 100% sure there's no autograd interactions involved, use the inference mode. It gives you performance benefits for free. And again, there's a link which describes how the inference mode works in more detail. And this is the latest edition. I think this was introduced in 1.9. So if you're on a previous version, you don't have this. The other optimization is this optimization called as setting grad to none. So if you recall, when we have an optimizer, we create the optimizer, we do an optimizer.step, and every time you do an optimizer.step, since the gradients are accumulated, you have to do an optimizer.0grad as well. And you do the 0grad so that the gradients are in the model are set to 0, and next time you do an optimizer.step, the gradients are added back. Now, optimizer.0grad, in some cases, can be an expensive operation because you're basically saying that, hey, there's this model. I'm going to take all the weights, I'm going to take their gradients, and I'm going to set them explicitly to zero. So let's say you have a model with 100 million parameters. So then you have 100 million, this is a very crude approximation, but let's say you have a network, a linear network with 100 million parameters. So then you are taking this 100 million parameter tensor and you are setting it explicitly to zero. And you are doing that so that next time new gradients are computed, you add them to zero so that the values are set. So this operation can be sometimes expensive. And now you can pass this additional argument called as set to none, in which case when you pass set to none, the gradients would not be set to zero, the gradients would be set to none. And this means you are not doing this expensive copy operation, you are just setting everything to none. So it would reduce the memory requirement. It should lead to faster performance, but there are some caveats. The caveat is setting the gradients to zero is not the same as setting the gradients to none. I mean, if you're doing the standard PyTorch training loop where you compute the gradients, you step through it, set the gradients to zero and so on, then everything is good. But if you're doing something more complex, then you need to be aware that setting the gradients equal to zero versus setting the gradients to none, this is different kind of behavior. Just to take one example of where this detail might matter to you, when we make a model, the gradients are none, right? So you might be having an if condition to see whether even one optimization step has been done or not by checking whether the gradients are none or not. So if gradients are none, this means no optimization has been done. But if you set optimizer.0grad set to none equal to true, this means the optimizer may have taken a lot of steps, but every time it would set the gradients to none and your if condition would fail. I mean, it would always pass, but your logic would fail. So you need to be aware to be careful about this difference between what it means to set the gradients to zero versus none. But if you are doing the standard PyTorch training loop, then this detail does not really matter to you. And I think this is also a somewhat recent edition, 1.7, I think. Let's see. So the optimizations that we talked about so far were more or less generic, or at least they were not super dependent on the model architecture. But this one, where we say that you can enable a QDNN auto tuner, this is somewhat more specific to the convolutional architectures. It would not work for other architectures. So it's not relevant for the architectures. So the idea is that you can set this operation torch.backends.codenn.benchmark equal to true. And what it is going to do is it's going to benchmark different convolutional algorithms to see which one is the fastest for your use case. And then it would select that one and run that. So it works only for convex. And the caveat is that it would make your results non-deterministic. So even if you set seats and everything, running the same experiment again with the same seed is going to give you different results. So that's the caveat that it comes with. But if that is okay for you, or if your variance is low enough, then you can set this flag and it would give you faster performance. If there are any questions, feel free to ask them. Okay. The next optimization is, whenever you have to do multi GPU training, you have this high level choice between DDP versus data parallel. DDP is distributed data parallel versus data parallel. And whenever you have to do multi GPU training, it doesn't matter how many GPUs you have, you should always go for distributed data parallel and not for data parallel. In fact, at this point, data parallel is deprecated. At some point, it would just be dropped and it would not even be available. And the reason for using distributed data parallel versus, I mean, the reason of preferring distributed data parallel instead of data parallel is distributed data parallel uses processes or multiprocessing, whereas data parallel uses multithreading. And in Python, if you're using multithreading, then your bottleneck or your performance is limited by the GIL, the global interpreter lock. So even if you are using a lot of GPUs, you're bound or you're contending for the GIL. Whereas with the distributed data parallel, you have one process for every GPU. And so every process can run in parallel. So there's no GIL interference or there's no contention for the GIL. So there's almost no use case where data parallel would be faster than distributed data parallel. And at this point, you should not be using data parallel at all. Okay, then this optimization about using pointwise operators, this is also pretty nice and pretty useful. The idea with the pointwise operators is, let's look at the GALU function, which is written here. So we have an X, which is being multiplied by half. Then there is a 1 plus tar.erf X divided by 1.4. So there are a lot of pointwise operations. And what I mean by a pointwise operation is, let's say X is a tensor of shape 100 plus 100. And I'm multiplying it by 0.5, which means I'm taking every element in X and I'm multiplying it by half. So it's a pointwise operation. Another example of pointwise operations is, for example, the ReLU nonlinearity, where you take X and you apply the ReLU operation on every single entry in X. So these are called as pointwise operators, where the operation operates on every single point in the tensor. Now, when you have these pointwise operations, and when you have multiple of them, so for example, in this case, I have X multiplied by 0.5, multiplied by something else, multiplied by something else, and so on. So when I have these multiple pointwise operators, the way they would work is PyTorch would take the code, it would create, or it would look at the corresponding kernels, and it would launch a lot of kernels. So I think in this case, it's going to be 1, 2, 3, 4, it's going to launch 4 or 5 kernels for the GALU call. And there's an overhead for launching these kernels. So these kernels are not free. You pay the price of actually running them, but you also pay a price for launching them. And what Fusion does is it takes all these pointwise operators and it converts them into a single kernel call. So now you are not paying the overhead of multiple kernel calls. So for example, and we'll talk about how we are doing it, but if you look at the fused GALU, it's going to make just one kernel call, whereas the original GALU was making 4 or 5 kernel calls. So you start saving the cost of making these kernel calls. And the way you enable this is, there are a bunch of ways of doing it. The simplest way probably is, or the way which is least intrusive to your workflow is the idea of using scripting. At a high level, you can do scripting or tracing. The example I'm showing here is scripting. What you do is you add this decorator @torch.jit.script, and Torch is going to take this function, its definition, it's going to, in a way, rewrite it so that it uses a single kernel call. And that's it. That's all you have to do. And this is not just limited to functions. You can also write modules, or you can also script or JIT modules. That becomes a little bit more complex, a little bit more involved. For the standard cases, it's still very straightforward. In some cases, it can be a little bit more tricky. There's this link where you can go and read more about how JITing works and how tracing and scripting works. At a high level, the difference between scripting and tracing is, and we don't have an example of tracing here, but when you look at the JIT documentation, you'll see two big things. You'll see script and you'll see trace. The main difference between trace versus script is trace takes an input example, so you need to provide it a dummy example, and trace is actually going to run that example. Whereas scripting is not, it's not asking you for a dummy example. It's you give it a function or a class and it scripts it. So that's the main difference. The places where you have to be careful when using scripting is if you have if conditions or control flow within your function. So let's say there was this function which had an if condition, then you have to be a little bit careful about how you're using scripting or tracing. But otherwise, fusing point-wise operators, it's very useful, and it gives you good performance benefits. Another thing is all the things that I've discussed so far, these are things that I regularly use in my workflows. So my point is that these are reasonably easy to use things, and there might be a little bit of friction to get started with. But over time, these would just become your default values. For example, setting the pin mem equal to true, it's a default. Just set it up and you're good to go. Now let's look at some more complex examples. And the reason I call them a bit more complex is because they are complex to implement. It's not complex to understand. It's just a bit more complex or a bit more involved to implement those things. So we just talked about that we can fuse these point-wise operators. If you think about the optimizers that we have, the optimizers have a lot of multiplications and basically they have a lot of point-wise operations. So does this idea of fusing point-wise operators apply only for models, or does it apply for optimizers as well? Yes, it absolutely applies for optimizers. Now, the thing is, most of the time we are using optimizers which are already implemented. We don't implement our own optimizers. So how do we enable things like jitting or tracing or fusion for those cases? Well, it turns out a fused version of some of the optimizers are already available. So you can just start using them, and so you don't have to do it manually. You can just start, you don't have to implement them yourself. You can start using them. So there's fused Atom, there's fused LAMP, fused Novograd, fused SGD. It's a little bit more involved because you need to build these operators. But these are available, and if you want, you can start using these fused optimizers instead of the vanilla optimizers that we have been using so far. But yes, this is a little bit more work as compared to the things that we have seen so far. The other optimization that we often do is checkpointing the intermediate buffers. So how does PyTorch work is you have a module, and let's say the module has 100 layers. So you pass in an X, and you track the activations of these 100 layers. And during the backward pass, you have these activations and everything works. Now, the problem with tracking these 100 activations is that you need a lot of memory for doing that. And if the model size is very large, then your batch size becomes small because the total memory on the GPU is limited. Now, the idea of checkpointing the intermediate buffers, to be clear, this checkpoint is not the standard model checkpointing that we talk about. Like, it's not about saving the model. So just want to avoid that confusion. Checkpointing here means that we are going to checkpoint the activations from the model or the output of the model, and not just the output of the final layer, but the output of the intermediate layer. So what we would do is we would do this f of x, we'll get the output for the intermediate layers. And earlier we were keeping the output of all the intermediate layers. In this case, we would keep the output of only a few intermediate layers, and we would recompute the other outputs. So we are not going to track the output of all the 100 layers. And since we are not tracking the output of all the 100 layers, this means I can free up some memory. And if I can free up some memory, and given the GPU has a fixed size, this means I can now support a bigger batch size. So the idea is compromise some of the memory. So reduce some of the memory usage, which means you're going to recompute some stuff in the backward pass, which means you're gonna take a bit longer. But since you have reduced the memory, you can use a larger batch size. And since you're using a larger batch size, that might help you to perform the required number of updates faster. So this is more of a trade-off. Well, it's an optimization for memory, but at the same time, it can cause you extra cost in terms of running the system. The other thing is be careful when you are doing this CPU-GPU synchronization, and avoid it as much as possible. So the computing model of GPU is you submit an operation, and the operation happens asynchronously. So it's like I've said, hey, do this matrix multiplication. And the moment I say this, do the matrix multiplication, I get the control flow back, and the GPU is going to do it whenever it gets time or something. So it's a non-blocking call, basically. But the moment the CPU says, hey, give me something from the GPU, that becomes a blocking call, which means your entire code waits for that particular operation to happen. And till that operation happens, nothing else can happen. And this is what CPU-GPU synchronization means. And what it means is if you do this synchronization very often, this means you're unnecessarily waiting for the GPU to finish its work and send you the data. So it's very obvious you understand that that's a bad thing. The harder part here is to identify when you might be doing the CPU-GPU synchronization. And so there are a few examples where a few examples of statements where you are doing CPU-GPU synchronization without even realizing that. So whenever you print a coo.insert, you are asking the GPU to send you the value on the CPU, and that's a synchronization operation. When you do something like coo.tensor.item, or when you take a coo.tensor and bring it to the CPU, all these are examples where you are forcing a synchronization. And even things like coo.tensor is not equal to zero, or basically any control flow equation, control flow logic, which depends on the value of a coo.tensor, these are all synchronization steps. So the point is not to do them ever. Obviously, there would be cases where you would have to do them, but do them, first of all, do them very sparsely, or do them only when it is absolutely necessary, and do not do them all over the place. Right? Like, because let's say I put a print statement, then I do a dot item statement, then I put a CPU statement. These three are going to be the blocking calls. Alternatively, I could just take this value, put it in a float or a int, and just print it three times. So then I would not be forcing the synchronization to happen three times. Okay. I think this is the last one, but so the idea here is that when we are using neural networks, we have the weights and biases and everything and the input, and all these things are the values are float data type, which means these are 32-bit floating values. The type is called as torch.float32. So we are doing floating point operations or 32-bit operations. But for a lot of cases, we do not really need to do 32-bit operations. We can even do 16-bit operations. And what's the benefit of doing 16-bit operations is, well, if instead of using 32 bits, I'm using 16 bits for everything, this means suddenly half of my memory is free. And if half of my memory is free, then this basically means I can use a bigger batch size, I can train faster. So the idea behind the mixed precision is, instead of doing everything in floating point 32 bits, do some of the operations in 32 bits and do the remaining operations in 16 bits. And this is what mixed precision means. You're using 32-bit precision as well as 16-bit precision, you're mixing it. How do you decide which operations to do in what precision? Linear layers, convolutional layers, these kind of operations are much faster in float 16. In fact, there are specialized kernels written for these. And then there are operations like reduction, mean, and so on. They need a larger range. So for operations like these, it's better to use the 32-bit range. And the idea behind mixed precision or AMP is automated mixed precision, I think, is that you use these two data types interchangeably and reduce the memory footprint so that you can use larger batches. It is also a little bit tricky to set up for the first time, and it can lead to issues like if you do not use it correctly, if you do not scale the gradients properly and so on, it can lead to issues where the training loss does not converge or the model does not converge. And there are a bunch of tips and tricks to handle that, which are available on the further reading link. Okay, so this was the part about the things you can do for making your model go faster. I'll stop here for a few minutes, and then we'll talk about how to do the profiling. But are there any questions at this point? Feel free to just jump in. This session goes much better when it's an interactive session. Okay, then
I think we can proceed, Shagun. Like, I think people are clear.
That is good. So let's talk about the profiling part. I purposefully changed the order, but when you go through the slides, the profiling part would be coming out first. So let's start with the profiling part. So the point of profiling is, how do you profile? We have already talked about a bunch of optimization tricks, but the point that we are focusing in this part of the presentation is, how do you profile these things to start with? So yes, so basically, how do we profile PyTorch operations or PyTorch models? Well, we don't need a new library. PyTorch ships with a library for profiling, so that's good. We don't need to install anything new. So PyTorch has this profiler built in, and you can import it with this standard from torch import profiler statement. This profiler takes care of CPU profiling, GPU profiling, memory profiling, time profiling, which operations are invoked, how many times are they invoked on CPU, GPU, and so on. So it takes care of everything. It works with TensorFlow, it works with VS Code, it works without these things as well. So it has integrations for these things, but if you do not want to use those integrations, it would still work for you. So it does cover a broad spectrum of use cases. Let's look at a few examples of how do we use them, and what kind of conclusions can we draw from them. So let's say I have a ResNet 18 model, and I want to profile this model. I want to see where exactly am I spending a lot of my time, or what operations are expensive. So the first thing I do is I make the model, and then I make a random input or a dummy input. I don't really care what this input is. I don't care about the model's performance in terms of accuracy. I just care about how much time does the model take. So I just make a dummy input of 5 images. Now, this is the model of input. So this is the forward call of the model in the third line. I'm putting two context managers. One is I'm saying I want to profile, and the activities that I want to profile are the activities on CPUs. In this case, I'm starting with CPU activities. We'll see how to do the same stuff with GPUs. And then I'm saying that I want to record the shapes. I want to record the shape of the intermediate operations. So I want to profile that, and then I'm putting this record function thing. This record function, the second line with profiler.record function model underscore inference. This is completely optional. This is put in because if you have a lot of profiling statements, then you should be able to say, hey, this profiling happened under model underscore inference. This profiling happened under something else. So profiler.record underscore function is more for defining some sort of namespace. But even if you comment it out, the output would not, the main output would not change. Just one caveat, when you're recording the shapes, well, the very fact that you're using a profiler means that your model is going to run slower. So TLDR, do not use a profiler for your usual use cases. Use the profiler only when you're profiling, because profiler has its own overhead. And this overhead increases when you start doing things like recording the shape. So if I am recording the shapes, the model is going to take longer, which means record the shapes if you think you need it. If you don't need it, you'll just be waiting longer for the model to get the profile out. Okay, so I run this, and then I get a model profile. And so let's see what are the different things I'm seeing here. So the first thing is the column called as name, where I have got these different function calls. And if you see, model underscore inference is something that comes out on the top, and it comes out on the top because in this case, there's only one thing which we are profiling, and we have put that thing under model underscore inference, which means whatever time we spend on model profiling, all that would be counted under model underscore inference as well. If I did not have this statement here, then the first line would not be there, but everything else would still be there. So that's why I said it's more for the convenience of putting things under some sort of namespace, but beyond that, it's not going to change much. So what we can see is, we can see how many times each function has been called. We can see how much, and this model was run on CPU, so we only have CPU time. We can see how much time does each function call take? How much time does it take on average versus how much time it takes on total? We also see the CPU total time. Now you will see that the CPU total column does not add up to one, and that is because it is not the CPU total time with respect to other operations. It's the time that you spent on that operation with respect to the total time that you took that it took for the profiler to run, which means a high level function like model underscore inference, which has a lot of other things going on, would be taking a lot of time. But if I start adding up the entire column, then I'm counting every operation multiple times. And that's why the values do not sum up to one. And at the bottom, I have the total CPU time, which is how much time was taken for running this entire thing, which is 750 milliseconds. Obviously, you can change things like the number of rows that you are interested in. You can sort by different things. All those things are doable. Generally, easier to just start with the CPU time total because that gives you a sense of where exactly are you spending most of your time. Okay, let's go to the next step. So we set up the model, we profiled it, we saw what's happening. Now let's see what happens if we try to optimize it. So remember, in this case, we are just doing an inference, right? We are not really training the model. So let's just take the torch.inference mode, which we talked about earlier. Let's put it there and let's see what happens. What we are expecting is that the time would be lower. It's not going to change the operators that I'm, it's not going to change the operations that I'm performing, but each operation should take lesser time now. So if you see that I have put this torch.inference mode statement here. Let's just quickly look at the time. It's about 750 milliseconds. There are a bunch of operations. Let's see what happens when we do this. Now that time from 750 milliseconds has come to 465 milliseconds. So that's a significant saving. Obviously that saving applies only if you're actually in the inference mode. If you're not in the inference mode, that does not apply. The more important and interesting thing is the name column does not change at all. The number of calls does not change because this inference mode is not changing your model, right? It's just changing what other informations, what versions, what views are you tracking, but it's not really changing your model definition itself. So if I was to put the two things side by side, you will see the name part remains the same. The number of calls are the same. What has changed is the amount of time we were spending in each operation. For example, the batch norm operation was earlier, the batch norm operation was earlier almost 100 milliseconds and it's now 72 milliseconds. So that's a saving of 28% right there. And this way you can perform the optimization that you think is useful. And then you can just compare these things and say, okay, so this makes sense and this does not make sense. So it makes it much easier to do this kind of comparison and to make one change in the system, evaluate its effect, then make another change and evaluate its effect and so on. The thing to keep in mind is in practice, when you are doing these things, doing one optimization or doing something that you think is an optimization, so you could have 10 things in mind which you think are going to optimize stuff, but when you do all those 10 things at the same time, it might not actually lead to a better performance or it might lead to some sort of diminishing returns. So having this kind of sideways comparison allows you to see what things are really useful and what things you do not want to put into the code. Okay, let's see. What's the next? Okay, so earlier we were doing this profiling on CPU, and now I want to do the profiling on GPU. So it's pretty much the same thing as before. I just added this extra profiler.profiler.activity.cura thing. So earlier I was just tracking the activity on CPU. Now I'm tracking the activity on the GPU as well. And everything else is more or less the same. Obviously I'm sending the model as well as input to the Cura device. So instead of looking at the CPU time, now I'm going to look at the Cura time now. So when I look at the Cura time, the table looks somewhat familiar. We still have the names, we have the total time spent on CPU and so on, and we now have the total time spent on GPU operations as well. And earlier we were reporting only the CPU total time. Now we are also reporting the CUDA time, which is basically the GPU time. So with just one small change, you can start tracking the model's performance or profiling. You can start profiling the model on the GPU as well. This is the same view as the previous table. It's just that I have removed a bunch of columns. The takeaway again here is that if you add up the self.cura percentage time, that time is not going to add up to 100 because some of these things are being double counted. Another important thing to note is if you look at things like model inference and you look at the self.cura column tells you how much time did that specific statement or did that specific operation spend on CUDA. So model inference was something we were running in Python. I mean, we were running it, it's like a statement, it wasn't running on GPU, and so the CUDA time for that is basically zero. And similarly, things like A10 con2D, this is C code, but this is more like preparing to launch the kernel, and that's why, since the kernel would be run on the GPU, the CUDA time for this operation is also zero. So you see a bunch of statements where the CUDA time is zero, and that time is zero because these are statements which are preparing the CUDA kernel. And since they're preparing the kernel, they are not really learning anything on the GPU, and that's why the time is zero. But if you look at their CPU time, you do see that there is some CPU time for these things. So for example, A10 2D, it has some 135 microseconds, but it's not running anything on the CUDA. So it's also important to understand that there would be operations which would either run on CPU or CUDA, and you should not be worried as to say something wrong with my profiler because the CPU time is zero. Well, the CPU time is zero because the operation is running on the GPU, and that's why the CPU time is zero. Okay. So far, we were just profiling the time. Now we can also start profiling memory. And for that, you just need to pass this extra argument, profile underscore memory equal to true. Again, the more things you track, the more things you, for example, if you start tracking CUDA activity, you are going to pay a higher price, which means the profiling would take more time. Similarly, once you start profiling the memory, it's going to take even more time. So don't use profiling for your everyday training. Use it only for profiling. So I do that, and I read on the thing again, and this time along with the time, I have the memory or how much memory does each operation take. I have that part as well now. So you can go through that. One last thing I want to show is this idea of a profiler trace. So what we have been seeing so far is things like these tables, and this is useful, this is good. But there's a lot of information which these tables do not give us, right? So I can look at how much time each operation is taking, but I don't really understand who is launching what operation, or I don't understand if there are any places in my code where the system is not doing anything or it's waiting for data or something. So there are a lot of these things which are just not visible from these tables. And for that, you can use you can set up a profile trace. We'll look at a trace in a minute. But this is how you get a profiler trace. When you do something like profile.export, chrome trace, trace.json, you get a .json file. It's a bulky JSON file. And you can upload it either on VS Code or on Chrome. I'll show you how to do it on Chrome in a minute. But you can put the trace there, and then you can look at the order in which operations are executed. So let's do that. It might take a little bit of time because I went to Chrome. I typed in chrome:// tracing. You can do the same thing in VS Code. I'm not showing it to you on VS Code because it's harder to zoom in on VS Code, whereas in this case I can zoom in much better. So let's see. Yes, I have a bunch of traces, so let's just pick up this trace. I don't know what this trace is. Okay, and you'll have to give me a couple of minutes so that I can remove some information that is not required right away. Okay, what other things do we want to hide? None. Okay, I uploaded the trace. Obviously, you don't see anything right now. We are going to enable stuff piece by piece because if I enable everything at once, it's too many things to see. So I go to the processes and I see that I can enable the Python process. I can enable the Python processes running on CPU. Is this visible, or do you should I look at some way of, yeah, maybe this is better.
Yeah, this is better. Yeah.
Okay. So let's see. So I clicked on processes. I can look at the CPU processes, the GPU processes, or the Python traces. So let's start with the Python processes running on the CPU. You can zoom into it by pressing the W key. So let's see, what do we have here? So I have this high-level operation profile, which is running a forward call. And within the forward call, there are a bunch of these operations. So there are some operations which are performing a quant 2D. Then there are some operations which are performing an add operation. Then I have some operation which is batch norm. So these are all familiar things, right? Like, you know, there's a quantnet, then there's an add operation, then there's a batch norm, and you can actually see these things here. Another thing I want to highlight is, let's just zoom out a little bit. Yeah, so this is one single forward call, and this one single forward call is invoking all these different operations. So let's see what's the first operation that it is doing. So the first operation that it does is a quant2d, followed by add, followed by batch norm, followed by ReLU, followed by max pool. So going with the x-axis, you can actually see in what order different operations are executed. And this is a much more powerful view than the tabular view that we were looking at earlier. another nice thing that you can do is I can click on, let's say, the max pool 2D operation, go here on the bottom and look at how much time am I spending here, and bunch of other details. The other powerful thing to sort of notice here is, as I zoom in, let's look at the ReLU operation. So there's a ReLU, and then you see a sort of pyramid forming on top of it, which basically means that this ReLU operation internally calls this clamp underscore min operation, clamp underscore min underscore operation, which calls this clamp underscore min operation, which launches a CUDA kernel. So when we say that, hey, there's this Python thing and it launches a kernel, this is how you can see it happening. You call the ReLU, ReLU calls clamp underscore min underscore, which calls clamp underscore min, which launches the CUDA kernel. And we would look at the CUDA kernel as in how does that work, because it's not visible right now because we are only looking at the CPU activities. So is this part clear? So when we say, hey, it's going to launch a kernel, this is basically the launch kernel operation. Now let's enable the GPU processes. And we need to enable the process traces as well. So we don't need to enable the process traces right away. Let's disable the process trace for a minute. We'll come back to it. So at this point, we just had the CPU process. I enable the GPU process, and then you suddenly see that there are all these operations. Let's go there. You see there are all these operations which are running only on GPU, and these operations, these are named of the CUDA kernels, basically. So SG, MEM, and so on, these are CUDA kernels. Now, what I'm going to show you is when we actually register an operation like this, for example, when we do a launch CUDA kernel, that actually creates a process on the GPU and launches it. And so now I'm going to show you that part. And just a heads up, this is all going to become super crowded now. Async basically means these are async operations. Now let's see. Let's zoom out a little bit. Do you see all these red arrows going out from the CUDA kernel to the GPU? So these are basically all the asynchronous operations. So the interesting thing to note here is, let's say, I don't know, let's pick up this one. So there's this CUDA, so there's this one CUDA launch kernel. This CUDA launch kernel was launched at this time. It was registered, and then by the time it is actually executed, so it started here and it's probably executed somewhere around this time. So this is the asynchronous nature. You register the kernel here, you launch the kernel here. The kernel is launched sometime later on the GPU, and then you get the result back. So you launch it, and now if you have an operation where you say, no, I want the result right away, this means this would be launched, and then you would get something back. And this means all this time you are basically waiting for this operation to happen. And that's why you want to avoid all the CPU GPU synchronization unless you really need it. But is this part clear? So you register or you launch the kernels. These kernels are launched in their own sweet time. The x-axis is the same for everyone. So they are launched in their own sweet time. Something happens, you get the results back much later. And there are a bunch of other things that we can see into this, but if there are no specific questions, then we should probably not spend too much time on this. So let's get back to the slides. So there are a lot of other things that you can see with a view like this, which is something which we are showing here as well. The white spaces that you see in this screenshot, these are times where nothing really is happening. These are sort of, this is the time between launching one kernel and starting the next one. Okay, so if there are no other questions, we can start wrapping up. So we saw two views, right? One view was where we were looking at the tables. Then the second view was where we were looking at the trace, which was more like a time axis thing. There's another way to visualize these things, which is a flame graph, which looks something like this. Again, it depends on what kind of things or what kind of visualization you like, but even a flame graph style visualization is supported. So you can go on this link and see how to do that. I mentioned earlier that the profiler works both with TensorFlow as well as VS Code. So I generally use it with VS Code for most of my work, and you can use it with either of these two. Go to the link and see these steps for enabling that. There's also this other link, which is how to use the profiler for analyzing the long running jobs. Now, the way we were doing profiling, I was showcasing how the API looks like. But when we are doing profiling in practice, there's always a warm up stage where we let the model run for a few forward passes, and then we actually start the profiling. And how to set up those things properly are described in this link. But in this case, what we were in our presentation, we were mostly focusing on what can be done. But in practice, when you are doing profiling, you would be doing a few warm up runs as well. Okay, I think this is it. This was the last slide. We have already talked about this piece. So these are the references. Go through them, and if you have any questions, happy to answer that now.
I just have a quick question, Shagun. Like, when is the right time? Like, let's take if you're working in a project, like, when is the right time to start profiling the code, like, to better the optimization, start runtime in memory?
I think it really depends. Like, you know, honestly, let's say you're doing a research project and your model takes 2 hours to run. Maybe it can be done in 1 hour, but do you really care? So it's mm-hmm. if the question is when do I care, it's more like, I don't know, when it starts bothering you. But if the point is more about what's a good way, so there are two views, right? Like, one is the project-centric view where I care about it only because my project cares about it, and then there's this other view where you say, hey, but I care about it, and then what's a good time? If you want to figure out how to do these things, the sooner you do it, the better it is. Also, a lot of these things would transfer. What I mean is, once you have figured out, for example, we saw those white spaces and everything, right? Probably once you do fusion, those white spaces would go away. And then you suddenly realize, okay, so I can always do fusion. And if I do fusion, probably next time I'm profiling, 40-50% of my work is already done. So it builds on it. So because next time you'll do another project, you'll start doing fusion from day one, and then your profiling time would be much less. But from a project's perspective, do it if you need to do it, or if it's too slow for you.
Mm-hmm. So it's like kind of a trade-off where we just need the outputs, or like we just need to optimize, or like even squeeze out better performance. So based upon project, right? Like,
yeah. So if your end goal is to just focus on the project, then optimization is secondary, right? If your model is running in 2 hours, it's running in 2 hours, mm-hmm. and you're satisfied with that. If it's more about, hey, how do I start building this muscle? Then it's, or if you want to figure out how to do profiling properly, the sooner you start, the better it is. But obviously these mm-hmm. two things need not be 100% aligned.
Okay. So is it kind of wise to do, like, let's take if we complete a small milestone in our project and then do profiling and then again start some development work, or like once the development work is 100%, then we should start the profiling?
So milestones in projects, specifically research projects, are more based on hypothesis. So you have a hypothesis where you mm-hmm. say, hey, this model should work. And, you know, you may have finished coding the model in 1 week, and now for the next 3 weeks, you're just running experiments. So the question is, since I'm running experiments for the 3 weeks, can I not do profiling? No, you can do profiling. I mean, all I'm saying is, mm-hmm. if you say I'm first going to finish a milestone, milestones are based more on experiments. So, you know, you might mm-hmm. be able to do the profiling much before you have finished your milestone, because your code is ready. You're running the code anyway.
Mm-hmm. Sounds good. Do anybody have any questions? Like, feel free to like unmute yourself and then like ask your questions.
Okay, we can probably stop.
Yeah. Stop. Cool.